gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap, one love for all, so we all can make it in. Standing in the gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap, one love for all, so we all can make it in. Studying to show ourselves approved, rightly divine the word of truth, increasing our faith to envision our freedom, so we all can glorify our God. Standing in the gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap, one love for all, so we all can make it in, make it in, make it in, make it in. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter to the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter to the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter to the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter into joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter into the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say enter into the joy of the Lord. Joy of the Lord, Lord, joy of the Lord, of the Lord.
Good morning. Welcome to Standing in the Gap USA. This is our Christian education ministry where we attempt to narrow the gap between God and His people by standing on the Word of Christ. And we have been in a study called the Spirit World, the Spirit World. And it's been a very fascinating study, and we've come a little ways in it, but we have a lot to go. And in the Spirit World, we also talk about angels and demons. And we've been focusing the first part of the study on the angels. And well, the first part of today was on the tripartite man, how we are spirits encased in physical bodies. And then we talked about the spirits being the angels and the demons. And we've been concentrating on angels, and we're going to finish talking about angels here today, and we're going to transition over to talk about demons. Some of you have been really waiting on us getting to the demons, so we'll do our best to get to those today. So, as we go there, as we attempt to go there in this study, we don't start our studies without saying a word of prayer. Our Father and our God, we want to thank you for bringing us safely here, Father. And we want to thank you for the hedge of protection that you've put around us, Father, to allow us to be here. We want you to bless all those that are able to join us in on this live broadcast, and then those that will be able to review this at a separate time, a later time. Bless all them, open their hearts, their minds, Father, and give them the strength and encouragement of your word, Father. I also want to say a prayer. The last couple times we've met, Father, we've asked for prayer for my cousin, Dana, who passed away this week. She gained her wings. She had been suffering. We knew she went into hospice last week and she gained her wings, but no grief and all that, Father, because we know she was saved. She's a child of God, Father, and she never wavered. She never strayed from her commitment and her proclaiming the word of God. So, Father, I want to thank you for the time that we've been able to spend with her. I want you to bless her as she goes on to be with her parents, who I'm sure are glad to have her at this time. Thank you, Father. And, Father, we want to say a blessing to all mothers. Tomorrow is Mother's Day. And we know that the importance of our mothers and how dear they are to us. And we thank you for that, too, Father. So we ask you to bless all those who are listening, as we said, all in your name and for your sake. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. And also, I always introduce the person who keeps us running, the most important person in this partnership, collaboration, is who handles all the video and keeps us on air and all that, and tells me what I'm doing wrong when I'm doing something wrong. And so I want to introduce you to my wife, my partner, Marvel. Marvel, what you got?
Good morning, saints. Good morning. Happy Mother's Day, all of you mothers. And I want to tell you, if your mother's still alive, call her up, go over to her house, hug her, kiss her, let her know that you love her, because our mothers aren't with us all the time. Both Art and I are going to the cemetery tomorrow. So enjoy your mother while you have her. Because you're blessed and she's a blessing. I do want to let everyone know that you can look in the chat box for a link to today's outline. Actually, last week's outline and today's outline are both. There's a link that you can get number 5 and number 6. That's what we're going to be working on today. And then if you have the ability to click on the link and join us live in our room, I just love it when we have that interaction where we can see your face and your smile and hear your voice. So come on into the room, y'all, if you can. That's all I got.
All right. Thank you. That was well given. I'm not going to do a long review at all. As a matter of fact, the only thing that I'm going to do to bring us up to speed for those that may not have been here, whatever, I want to direct you to the previous broadcast, which you can view on YouTube and Facebook and other platforms, and also the outlines. So what we've been talking about, though, is angels, how they operate, how they are activated, and that's basically where we left off. The only thing I want to say about that for you to keep in mind before we proceed on here is that angels are activated by worship. The reason for that is that that's what they do 24/7. They worship God. That's their mission. They don't stray from that. So when we worship, sincere worship, fervent prayer and worship, it activates angels, and they tend to be attracted to that. And since they are our allies in this spiritual warfare, that's a good thing. You want them to be activated. You want them to be attracted to you. And all right. Now, as we move on from there, what I want to go for or get started on is to let you know we're finishing that first outline, or the outline we have been working on, and we're going to transition over to the outline that on demons. But there's still a little bit more to go with this, and I'm going to get started on it right now. One thing about angels we have to understand is that angels enforce the word of God. Word of God. And I put up on the screen Hebrews 2nd chapter 1-2, verses 1 and 2. We must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. For since the message spoken through angels was binding, and every violation and disobedience received its just punishment, how shall we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? See, the purpose of this scripture is to let you know that angels, for one thing, were there when scripture was given, and they rejoice and are activated by scriptures. And the angels have, as you know, violated, some of them violated and chose to go with Satan. And God did not spare the punishment on them. And their punishment is set, and they know where they're going to end up. Now, if God didn't relieve them of that punishment, then you know he's not going to relieve us either. And so that's where we are. How do we escape if we ignore so great a salvation? Meaning that God has given us a salvation from the punishment. But if we ignore that, we're not going to escape. We're going to receive our just punishment. And understand this. Angels are sent by God. They are activated by God. And they punish lawbreakers. Do not, and here's something to keep in mind. Do not call on angels if you're violating the law and disobeying authority, because they may appear.
But they're not bringing no blessing.
Right. angels respect, respond, and release the word of God. So, I said last week, angels are on a mission. Understand that angels are on a mission, and their mission is the word of God, the mission given by God. They don't stray from it. You can't negotiate with them when they appear. If you're not where you're supposed to be, then you don't want to be in that situation. Let's talk about angels and the confessed word. Angels are activated and released when we confess faith in the word of God. When believers worship, angels gather. Angels do his word. It's their job. It's their purpose. Angels will cause the word of God to come to pass in the lives of believers. And as we obey, heed, and confess the word of God, we bring our angelic allies into full partnership with us. They will bring to pass what God has promised. See, God, and some people wonder, well, why don't God just do it on his own? Why he need angels? Remember, God, we can't stand in the presence of God in our physical form. Okay? You remember when Moses was on the mountain, he couldn't even look, and God passed by and all that, and God's talking to him, and he comes down with this shining face. He got to put a veil on his face and all that kind of thing. So, God allows us to interact with angels, And also, angels answer prayer. Angels are especially attuned to the spiritual discipline of prayer. They're activated by a sincere heart seeking God in prayer. Scripture seems to tell us that angelic worship included watching over the prayers of believers. Because, see, what happened is we pray and we want the prayer to be answered right away, but God hears your prayer. So you went, what happens to my prayer? And then God heard it and he didn't do anything. He didn't answer my prayer. Don't give up faith. The prayer is still there. God has heard it. And the one that's looking over and preserving that prayer for God are the angels.
Now, a lot of times he sends them to answer the prayer, too.
Exactly.
I remember that in Daniel.
But if he doesn't answer the prayer right away, the angels are preserving it. Mm-hmm. God will deal with it in his time. Now, if we look at Revelation 5, as you know, we did the study on Revelation. Revelation chapter 5, the Lion, the Lamb, meaning Christ, seizes the scroll, and triumphant worship breaks out among those redeemed and among the heavenly hosts. Well, if you go to that chapter, you'll find out that the angels, one, it talks about the angels, of course, all in the throne room of God and surrounding God and ministering to God and all the others that are in the presence of God. But what I want to direct you to is that when Christ grabs the scroll, that he's the only one that can grab that scroll, too. And when he does, it fulfills the prophecies and all that. And the angels break out in worship to God. And then in that same chapter, you'll find those four living creatures who are angels also. And the 24 elders, all upon when Christ grabs that scroll, fall down before the Lamb, each with a harp and a golden bowl full of incense, as this graphic shows. They held gold bowls filled with incense. And what it says is that the gold bowls are filled with incense, which are the prayers of God's people. Remember what I said? That angels preserve over your prayers, even though they might not be answered yet. They are not forgotten. And so Revelation 5:8 reminds us of that. See, it appears that the prayers of believers across all time are being watched over by angels. The prayers of saints unleash, and the prayers of the saints unleash the seven trumpet judgments that we talked about in Revelation. And angels tend to our prayers, and their agents used to answer our prayers. And in due season, the Holy Spirit and the angels of fire move to answer the righteous prayers of believers. They availeth much, I tell you. They availeth much. Let's go to another scripture here. Luke 1:18-20. And this is Zechariah. An angel appears to Zechariah, talking about his prayers. I'm an old man. How can I be sure of this? Meaning that the angel told him that your prayers that you and your wife want to have a child, your wife has been barren, and now you're old and all that, but God has heard you. He's listened to you. I'm bringing you his answer. You mean they had prayed a long time, so they wondered what happened to our prayer. Oh, God, I'm not going to do it. I ain't heard anything. Here comes the answer. Boom. And he says, I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years. Angel said to him, I'm Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and tell you this good news. He's giving them some kind of gospel, right? Good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens. He was bringing him good news, and now he switched over to a little bit of bad news. And the bad news is that Zechariah doubted. And you will now be silent, not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time. Angel appears, and you know, people say, well, how do I know that this angel ain't a demon and all that kind of thing? One thing is, you will know. You will know. God's not going to send you down there and a doubter and all that stuff. Once that angel appears, you know. just have faith. You'll know. All right, now in summary, angels abide in the secret place of prayer. They abide, and on this graphic, we need to move to this graphic. Angels abide in the secret place of prayer. Angels, meaning that's where they're living, in your prayers. And they abide there. Angels are stirred and motivated by the individual and corporate prayer, meaning individual prayer or the corporate prayers of your church or your fellowship, your Bible study, whatever it is. They are stirred and motivated. Number three, prayer is best offered in the context of intense worship. Worship. All right. Let's not get all hung up on that.
We know that means worship. Worship.
I've had some people who, as when they see something like that, what are you doing? I'm not coming back here anymore. You misspelled a word. All right, sorry. Everybody has a little problem. Let's hope it doesn't send anybody away.
Well, you know what, honey? We should let the people know how you work on this class after you worked all day long and half the night on your job. Mm-hmm. And how many times you are working on this class way into the early hours of the morning. So y'all take that workshop and start to worship.
Make it a workshop of worship. All right, but what it's saying is that your prayer, when you have your prayer, don't just as pray at all time. But if you really want it to have power and all that, then offer it in the context of intense worship, meaning during your worship, your intense worship, your prayer. Boom. understand that that's it's best offered in that context. Number four, angels watch over prayers yet to be answered. We talked about that. Number five, prayers are a pleasant and sweet aroma to God, our Father. Yeah, and the Bible says that. As you read through it, it says it's a sweet aroma that's coming up to his nostrils because prayer. Angels pray and worship at all times, 24/7. And when God sees that coming from you, it works well in your behalf. Number six, prayers rise to God from the hands of our angelic allies. We showed that reference to Revelation, where the bowl, they have the bowl where the prayers are in there. And so they're involved in your prayers. Ha, how about that? Seven, angels respond negatively to wrong words, negative confessions, curses, and unbelief, and all that hinders the miracle working word of God. Number eight, our final summary. Prayers offered in passionate faith and trust in God will be answered by God, and they will be delivered by angels. Remember that, delivered by angels. All right, let's move on. Angelic activity, and even before we get to Luke 17:21, angelic activity is on the increase in these last and final days. You see, as the end nears, we know that powerful demonic forces are unleashed and our human options begin to dwindle, meaning we rely on our options here in the physical world and all that. But as this demonic activity increases, our options in our physical world are going to decrease. And then as the demonic activity increases, God releases angels to protect his people and to and the promise of his kingdom and to promote his kingdom. So as demonic activity increases, angelic activity increases on the behalf of believers. And we need to know how to place ourselves in the best position that we can to receive this supernatural influence from God, these allies that we have, and how to activate those forces or influence in the world. And one thing we have to understand, we're not waiting on the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God dwells with us and is here now. It dwells in us and is here now. We go to Luke 17:21. Once on being asked by the Pharisees where the kingdom of God would come, Jesus replied, "The coming of the kingdom of God is not something that can be observed. Nor will people say, 'Here it is,' or 'There it is,' because the kingdom of God is in your midst right now." And see, once we are born again, we will have full access to the resources of the kingdom. Remember, we're all born sinners. We have to be born again, born in the Spirit, and connect ourselves to the teaching and the word of the Holy Spirit. And once we do that, we have full access to the resources of the kingdom that is here in our midst right now. Next scripture, Hebrews 2:8-9. Thou hast put all things in subjection under his feet. Talking about Christ. For in that he put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that is not put under him. But now we see not yet all things put under him. And what that is saying is that all these things are you can receive through Christ. Okay? And there's nothing that was left out that you won't have access to when you're born again in the kingdom. But now, as now in our physical time right now, we can't even see all things that are put under him. What do we see then? We see Jesus. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, and that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. What that means is that Okay, you can't see all the things that you are entitled to right now. But you know what? God took care of that. Why? Because he let us see Jesus. And that's all we need to see. That's all we need to see. It is by the Holy Spirit that the kingdom breaks through into the now. The Holy Spirit releases the power of the kingdom now. When a church or a believer is willing to sell out completely. Now, let me repeat that. Sell out completely. Now, you're going to do your half sell out or your quarter sell out or your 1/8 sell out. No. When the church or a believer is willing to sell out completely, angelic activity will increase exponentially.
That's what they mean when they say, all to Jesus I surrender.
All to Jesus I surrender. Let's talk about angelic ministry in the church. See, when the church brings those who are lost to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, meaning the salvation, of course, the angels join in the celebration and praise for their conversion. You know how when somebody joins the church or when somebody is born again, they have a ceremony. They come down and they ask them all these things and they say, yeah, I'm ready to commit my life and all that kind of thing. And you know, they're in the process of being born again, okay? But and that's our celebration. We, a lot of times, we rise, we clap our hands and all that, and we celebrate. What we don't understand or know is that angels are joining us in that celebration and praise for that conversion. Let's go to a scripture on that. Luke 15:10. Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. So they're born again. They take their, go down in the water and raise up in the water, the baptism and all that kind of thing, which is a symbolic conversion. The angels are there and they're celebrating too. And you say, well, I don't see them and all that. Remember, we've already talked about that. Angels are around you all the time right now. Now, you may not be able to activate them because you're not doing what you're supposed to do. That's not going to stop them from worshiping when someone accepts Christ into their life. And when the church gathers for worship, angels gather with us. Understand that. Let's go to another scripture. Hebrews 12:22. But ye are come unto Mount of Zion and unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels. You see, angels gather with us when we're worshiping in church. And this is talking about your corporate worship in your church. They gather with us. And they also lead us. Hebrews 13:17. Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourself, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. You see, angels accompany those who lead. Who are those? Your pastors. Ushers, your trustees, your deacons, and all that. And angels speak the word of God, they teach faith, and watch for our souls, as do those leaders. And they release profit or prosperity. And what they're saying is that do it with joy. When you're a leader, do it with joy, not with grief, because that's unprofitable for you. Meaning, if you're going to be a leader, and see, I take that very seriously when I teach. I do know that I'll be held accountable for teaching the wrong thing.
Leading, or doing it with the wrong attitude.
Right. Leading people astray and all that. But the angels are there to help me, to assist me. And I have to call upon their help. You see, those who mock and make fun of men and women of God are blocking the ministry of angels. And we must always remember, do not neglect to show hospitality to strangers. For doing that, some have actually entertained angels without even knowing it. Hebrews 13:2. We're about to get into demons, but the final thing on the part of the angels is angels execute, we need to know it, angels execute God's wrath. Angels will release the judgments that are yet to come. And with God's wrath fully released, the book of Revelation reveals two phenomena that intensify at the same time. Worship increases in a powerful crescendo that shakes all of creation. Worship increases in the last and final day. But wars and catastrophes intensify. God's wrath is carried out by angels and has been evident throughout Scripture. If you look at 1 Chronicles 21, one angel stretched out his sword over Jerusalem and 70,000 men of Israel died in a plague. Angels announced the judgment of Sodom and Gomorrah in Genesis 19. In 2 Kings 19, Hezekiah prayed and a warring angel killed 185,000 Assyrians. In Acts 12, an angel struck down King Herod for his pride. In the book of Revelations, we see that angels are the enforcers of God's wrath on a cursed earth. In the first three chapters, angels are assigned to the churches and are active in communicating God's will. In chapters 4 and 5 of Revelation, angels join all creation in the most majestic worship service ever. And you need to go back and read that, because that is the most majestic worship service ever. And after that, angels begin to blow trumpets that usher in horrific judgments on the planet. Then wars, famines, plagues, and natural disasters claim one-third of the population of the earth. Then angels pour out the seven bowl judgments. Angels bring down false religions and usher in the collapse of the financial system, that great prostitute they call. Angels accompany Jesus on his second coming. One mighty angel captures Satan, throws him into the lake of fire to join the Antichrist and the prophet. And all unsaved are cast into hell by angels. See, God's wrath on Satan was released at the cross, even though it comes to fulfillment in the end, in the final days in Revelation. Remember that while all those terrible prophecies will come true, it's going to come to pass. All demonic forces are already defeated by the finished work of Jesus on the cross. We're operating in victory here. Jesus triumphed over death to prove to us that it holds no power over us. And Jesus promises that because he lives, even though he died, yet will we live, even though we die. So we are released from the fear of death, which throughout our lives has subjected us to bondage. The fear of death. And remember this too, the devil is subject to Jesus, but he's not subject to those who are not followers of Jesus. Let me say that again. The devil is subject to Jesus, but those who are not followers of Jesus, they've opened themselves up to the full wrath of the devil. And as you see, we're now able to move on. Talk about some demons, right? As you know, if you've been noticing this graphic here, this graphic that you have been seeing has shown the angel on top of the screen and the demon underneath. But now, since we're getting into demons, we're flipping that over. This lets you know that we are totally and absolutely now into demons.
Before you go on, I just want to open it up to the people that are here. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the chat box so that Art can address them as we move in from the angels to the demons.
All righty. Are you ready?
I ain't ready for no demons.
All right, let's get some basic tenets under control here as we understand that we're involved in a battle that's even beyond the stars. You say beyond the stars. Remember the other realms, okay? The third heaven and the spiritual world and all that. That's what it's a battle beyond the stars. And one thing we have to understand is that the Western world has basically, in the Western world, okay, Greece, Rome, all of Europe, United States, and all that Western world, all right, has basically rejected the idea of supernatural evil. Naturalism has taken over. Naturalism has taken over. And what is naturalism? The belief is that the world can be understood through verifiable, rationalistic, and explainable terms. And there's no place for good and evil in what we call the new enlightened scientific era. However, as we learned in our study, God's Not Dead, if you haven't seen that study, you can go back and take a look at it because it's a great study. As we learn, God's not dead and good and evil exist and cannot be explained by naturalistic thought. As a result, Christians must face the supernatural, the historical, and even contemporary fact that there is actually a supernatural enemy out there. Now, if all you're dealing with is the naturalistic rationale or philosophy, then you are rejecting that there is an evil out there. And we've begun to take this supernatural enemy for granted. And actually, we don't even respect its unimaginable power. See, if we don't accept that there is a supernatural, then that supernatural can dominate over us because we're not in a position where we can defend ourselves, even understand what's going on. Evil has become a thing of good movies, books, entertainment, and video. And so I'm asking Marvel to put up a video here.
We're going into the
MJ. You see, the world has begun to believe that there's no supreme evil, and it's all just fun and games, it's just a joke, and all that. And Satan is characterized as wearing a red jumpsuit with tail horns and a pitchfork. As a result, most people underestimate him as the enemy, as their enemy. And the true path to defeat is to underestimate your enemy. Spiritual warfare demands that we have a healthy recognition and knowledge of our enemy, along with a thorough knowledge of our own identity. We must understand our enemy and understand our power. Know the power of the enemy, but also know your own power and who are your allies. And understand, as we move on, understand there is something wrong with the world. Martin Luther King mentioned that in one of his sermons. There's something wrong with our world, something fundamentally and basically wrong with the world. Our world is a beauty to behold and wondrous in its majesty, yet there is an ugly side. Scripture tells us that God created heaven and earth and planted man in the garden, where lived the only being who made no bones that he challenged the authority of God, that he hated God, and hated the creation of man, of us. We know God loves us, but forces are in play that are trying to destroy us. And that force is not loving at all. We know that force as Satan. And Satan can take on many forms. As we know, in the garden, he took on the form of a snake. And we know that he was cast out of heaven, and he was a Lucifer, known as the anointed cherub. And actually we know him as the perfect cherub. He was said to be the perfect cherub. So he had this position before he was cast out. And he was a position of authority over all the angels. He was their worship leader, or whatever you want to call him. As we move on, we see that he's noted to be that perfect cherub. That perfect cherub. Scripture says he was beautiful. The fault was found in him, and he wanted to dethrone God and sit on the throne himself. This led to his expulsion to the earth along with one third of all the angels. And after he was thrown to the earth, as we move on, we see that he's thrown to the earth in this graphic, and he's now on the earth. He's now doing his thing with his one third of all angels. Now, some believe that this occurred in what they call the gap theory, which we talked about previously, which is, you know, some think that there's a gap between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2. The angels who chose, and we know the angels who chose Satan became demons. And the job of demons is to carry out the will of Satan and to torment us and lead us from the path of salvation. And understand this, they are good at what they do. They wait for a chance to enter into our lives through doors that we open for them to enter. They can only do... And this is very important. They can only do what we allow them to do. See, we must understand that the battle is being waged, is that the battle that is being waged in the spiritual world, our realm, is a battle for your immortal soul. That's the battle. Demons exist only to kill, steal, and destroy. And the Bible is not silent about the existence of Satan and of his demons. Demons have the power to possess the bodies of men and women, if allowed to. Remember that, if allowed to. They can take on human form. They can enter into sexual relations with human beings, meaning through that one that they possess. They can cause mental illness. Mm-hmm. And their biggest weapon is deceit. Is deceit. Did God really say that you should not eat that apple? Did God really say that you should not fornicate? Did God really say that thou shalt not kill or steal? And we need to understand something too. There are those that worship Satan. Yeah. There are those that worship Satan. You know, we see that in the movies and all that. And, you know, a lot of you probably doubt that, you know, and all that kind of thing. There are those who actually worship Satan. Which means that if that's the case, that means Satan is being successful.
With some of them, yes.
Yes. He's not just sitting back being defeated on everyone, because see, as I said the last time, is that I believe Satan and the demons know that in the end they're going to lose. Now, I can't show you any scripture that says that, but I believe they know that, okay? Because when Christ comes, one of the demons asked him, have you come? It's not our time. So that makes me think they know. Okay, but if they know that they are defeated, then the question is, why do you keep going down this road?
They're spoilers.
Yeah, they're
they're spoilers. We're gonna pick off everybody we can.
There you go.
On our way down the tubes.
And why is that? Well, that's because misery loves company, I think. So if we gotta lose, we're gonna take as many of you with us as we can. But understand that there is actually a Satan church. A Satan church. There are men and women who worship Satan. There are self-proclaimed witches and warlocks. There are magicians who gain power from the devil. And their numbers are on the rise. If you don't think that's true, the people, look at what's happening in the world today with all these conspiracy theories and all that stuff that's on the rise, and all the people turning away from what they know is right and all that, and saying things they know is wrong and all that kind of thing, and not caring about any consequences and all that. All that stuff is on the rise right now. And some are devil worshipers and don't even know they're devil worshipers. You see, don't think you can control, battle, or defeat demons on your own. You can't. They're very powerful. Remember, they were once known as angels, who are much more powerful than we are. And just like angels, they are spirits who are on the job 24/7. They don't take a break. And especially if they see a little crack in the doorway in your life, they're going to be on that 24/7 until you actually open that door and let them in. Just like angels, they can be all around you and you would never even know it. Now I'm going to ask Marvel to put up a video to enforce that there is a Satan church and there are those that worship Satan.
Some time ago, the wire services and newspapers carried a story out of San Francisco describing the first satanic wedding ceremony ever performed. The pictures showed a nude woman lying on the altar behind the guest, whom you see now, the Reverend Anton Zandor LaVey, who is the founder and high priest of the First Church of Satan. Anton Zandor LaVey uses as somewhat of a credo this timeless quote, "Remember, evil backwards spells live." Somehow that never occurred to me.
Never occurred to me until one of my disciples brought it forth, and I imagine it's quite true with many of us.
How often do you have to shave your head to make it shiny like a devil?
I have to put Vaseline on it as well to keep it shiny. I shave it once a day. Can I give a plug?
Is that the odor you're giving off now, Vaseline?
No, that's...
You're gonna fool me.
That's musk.
That's musk.
That's the goaty scent you smell.
For sure it's not frankincense and myrrh.
No.
Now, what is this ring you're wearing here? Looks like it's weighing your hand down.
Well, no, it's a magical ring.
It is?
I have little children rub it, make a wish, and it comes true.
Little children come near you?
Of course. Little children
and animals. What kind of a wish did that ring ever make come true?
Well, I would say a great many wishes, but we won't go into them.
Now, you call yourself a satanic priest.
Yes.
Is that the opposite of God?
No, because Satan is a god, too.
Mm-hmm. Well, what are you then, the dirty pope or what?
Oh, I guess you could call me that if you want to say the black pope or the dirty pope or the advocate of, for example, the kingdom of night or darkness. No one's ever come forth so far and spoken up for the devil. Everybody that's made rules and regulations concerning the devil or the devil's work, the devil's activities, have been people that have been very righteous people, people during crusades, people...
Well, I'm not too righteous, but on the other hand, I think you're a bit of a ding-a-ling, let's face it. Were you ever a religious fellow?
I would say not particularly.
You're a young man.
I'm a religious fellow now, though.
How old are you?
I'm 36.
36. Who ordained you a satanic priest?
I would say probably I received the call. Just as any fundamentalist...
Well, most of us do, but we fight it.
Well, I fight it. This is, of course, the whole principle of my religion, is all of the
concepts... What do you mean you received the call? You mean one day the devil said, go out, Anton Zandor LaVey, and give people hell. Huh? Is that what happened?
That's about it. Because people like to have a hell of a time, don't they?
Well, of course, there are all kinds of definitions of that.
Well, now...
Now, I don't, you know, I mean, to marry two people without a license in front of a naked babe lying up on an altar, I don't know what that is.
Well, seriously, there are explanations for these things. And how I started was as a result of various reverse forms of therapy. I haven't been a satanic priest all my life, as you probably gathered.
You've probably been an inmate part of your life.
Well, an inmate in possibly a pretty big institution.
Are you at all afraid that someday after you get through this big put-on, that, you know, with your little red yo-yo and your big fat ring and your shiny bald head, that when they do pack you away...
Well, now, wait a minute.
If there's any justice, you know, you've got to really get it.
Yes, sir.
Are you planning on training a lot of little devils?
Only those that wish to become little devils.
Are you married?
Oh, yes.
You have any little devils?
Oh, yes, I have two.
Are you going to raise them as satanic kids?
Certainly, but not to go around chopping people up or sacrificing human beings, just to...
That would be the greatest reward of all if your kid some night would creep in and set fire to you and your lion.
Well, no,
huh?
No.
And then dance around with pitchfork and say, look at daddy, look at daddy. Huh? Now, if you sleep with your lion, where does Mrs. Devil sleep?
Well, she sleeps with the lion, too, you see. Not between us, though. The lion's on one side.
Makes for a nice grouping.
I don't believe in separating church and state.
There are some people in the dock who would like to speak to you. We'll be going to the dock and the devil after these words.
You know, that's the real guy that proclaimed himself to be the pastor, I guess you might call it, or the head of the Satan Church. He established a Satan Church, Satanic Church. And, you know, I presented that to you so you understand that there are those people out there. And we look at them as being nuts and crazy and all that kind of thing. But they're on a mission, too. Why? Because they're possessed by demons. And demons are on a mission. And so don't underestimate. Do not doubt that the demonic forces are out there. As we said, you cannot fight your battle if you don't know who your enemy is.
And they're going for our youth. Too.
Mm-hmm.
They're going for our youth. They got crosshairs on them.
If you have any idea why is our youth doing this, or why even not even our youth? I mean, look at the Taylor Greene. What's her name? Marjorie Taylor Greene.
Oh yeah.
And all those that are in politics. And I always tell you, be careful when you get into politics, because they're going to ask you to do some demonic stuff. And one is lie in the midst of evidence that proves to everybody that you are lying, and they want you to just maintain that lie or whatever. That's demonic. It's got to be. And those that like like Putin over there, who killing women and kids and all that for no reason other than the fact that he wants to gain power and territory and all that kind of thing. It's on the evil is on the is marching. It's on the rise. We have the ability and the power to fight it. We have angelic allies, angelic beings who are engaging in that war right now, that spiritual warfare. And you know, I think that they would be very, very accepting of us joining them in that war. And how do we join them in that war? We activate our angels. We fervently pray and worship. We stand on the word of God. And along with the angels, we declare war. We declare war on the demons and on the devil. And I'm asking Marvel to end our broadcast today with a reminder of that. We're in a war, people. We are in a war. Accept it. Declare it. Join with our angelic allies in that
war. I got joy in my soul. God is in control. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back. Cause this means war. This means
war. To be in a war that you know that you have already been declared the victors. And as we said before, even though we are victorious already, we have to play this out to the end of time. We're going to be dealing with these demonic forces until God decides that it's time to wind it all up. So right now, we're in the middle of a war. Understand that. It's a spiritual war. Understand who your enemy is. Understand how you activate your allies in this war, the ones who are already fighting this war on our behalf. We have the ability to do that. They are going to win. You might want to get in on the winning side. All right. So as we move, we're definitely in the middle of the demons, and we're going to get into even deeper the next time we get here. So keep an eye out for a new outline, and we will get this thing going, this spiritual warfare that you're involved in. Become a soldier. Fight on the side of the winners. All right. Marvel, anything?
No, I don't have anything. Just happy Mother's Day, everybody. Enjoy your Mother's Day weekend.
This means war, y'all. All right, let us pray. Our Father and our God, we want to thank you, Father, for the message that we've been able to receive here today, Father. We definitely want to be on the right side of this spiritual warfare, Father. So we're going to join with your angels in this war against demonic forces, Father. And we ask that you unleash the power of the angels in our lives, Father, as we get on that battlefield, as we fight, Father. We want to be strengthened, encouraged, and led by your angels, Father, because we know that we are victorious, Father, and we know that when we weaken, that you will strengthen us, Father, that you'll show us the way. And we want to thank you for that. Father, put a hedge of protection around us as we proceed out into the world this week, Father. Put a hedge of protection around us, Father, as we know the news and it's not going to be good. A lot of demonic forces that are being conveyed to us in the news, Father. But keep us in constant memory that we are victorious. We've already won this war, Father. Bless all the mothers, Father, as we celebrate our mothers, whether they're living or whether they're gone, Father. We remember them, we love them, and we thank you for them, Father. And we ask all this in your name and for your sake. Amen.
Amen.
Gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap, one love for all, so we all can make it in. Standing in the gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap. One love for all, so we all can make it in. Studying to show ourselves approved, rightly divine the word of truth, increasing our faith to envision our freedom, so we all can glorify our God. Standing in the gap, standing for Jesus, standing in the gap for family and friends, standing in the gap, one love for all, so we all can make it in, make it in, make it in, make it in. Wanna hear him say good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say, good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say, good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say, good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say, good, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into the joy of the Lord. Wanna hear him say, good and faithful servant. Wanna hear him say, enter into the joy of the Lord. Of the Lord. Joy of the Lord, Lord, joy of the Lord, of the Lord.